So, welcome back. After the summer vacation, I think we are meeting for the first time. Last week we could not meet because it was the last day of the summer break. So let me just quickly recap what we have discussed so far, and if you have any queries, please put forward so that we can have some clarification. And before I proceed to the next topic, please let me know if you have any kind of queries which you have faced some hardships during this break, which you have while you are learning. If you have faced some difficulties, just please let me know. I'll try to clarify you. So if you see the syllabus, I'm just getting back to the syllabus. So hope my screen is visible to you. Syllabus PDF.
Yes, sir, visible. Yeah.
Fine. So as for this curriculum, the contract or whatever it may be, call it as syllabus. So we have started our web technologies introductory course with the technologies such as HTML forms and CSS, cascading style sheets. So we started to learn about how to design and develop web pages using this basic fundamentals with the hypertext markup language. Of course, we are able to design some of those web pages, and then we slowly added some functionalities to the elements of the web page. So those functionalities, by understanding how do we write the JavaScript. So this JavaScript programming language was helpful for us to manage and control various web page elements. Those web page elements, we usually call it as the document object model op elements or DOM objects in simple terms. So we were able to manage and control various elements, get the data from an element and traverse the elements using the DOM hierarchy, and place the data appropriately and process the data. So once we understood about the basic fundamentals of JavaScript, the HTML, CSS, then we started to understand about how do we represent those web elements using an extended markup language, which was helpful for us to traverse the data across the web pages. Not only XML, we also have had a small understanding on the JSON object notation, JavaScript object notation, so that both the XML and JSON were helpful for us to exchange the data between the documents or among the resources or the web resources, in fact. So after going through these first three units, of course, we also have done some exercises and we started understanding on this. So a week-wise exercise has been given to you, and you have already completed those exercises. Then we move on to, then we went to the topics of jQuery and AJAX technologies. Of course, jQuery is an advanced form of your JavaScripts, and AJAX technology is helpful for you to fetch the data from the web servers in the real time. Of course, we have not completed the all the features, if not all the features, at least the some basic fundas were been I have dwelled upon and started practicing on this. So hopefully somewhere here on interacting with the CSS stylings and getting and setting the values of the DOM elements using jQuery, we stopped at this point. So most likely the highlighted portions are being covered. So these topics are already available on the Moodle website. So if you see here, we started with HTML and CSS, then the responsive web designs for various display devices to display our web pages. Then we move on to JavaScripts and document object modeling, and we then do XML and JSON for exchanging of data between these web pages. and the basics of jQuery and Ajax. So you are trying to do understand more on the jQuery features, how you can retrieve the elements and how do you process the elements using the advanced jQuery library and the methods which are supported by the jQuery. So we have interrupted at that point. The advanced functions of jQuery we have not completed yet. So these are the things, and the recorded versions are already available to you, and the exercises are already given to you, and you have solved, many of you have solved it, and suppose you have received your feedback and the marks of those assignments. If you have any queries on this up to this particular point, let me know. Of course, as per the syllabus, we stopped at this point, and these are the things which are remaining, the Ajax and the advanced jQuery elements. We have to cover from this point to the rest of the syllabus. So these are the highlighted lines are the remaining part of our syllabus for the next 6 weeks. So of course, as per the, we will be comfortably come, we'll be covering the syllabus, of course. Covering the syllabus is not a difficult task from my perspective. The only thing is how far you are able to digest and how far you are able to infer the things properly and act accordingly is the question. So the syllabus point of view, we will be going through these contents for the coming weeks. Before going to these topics, so if you have any queries that you have faced or you had some problems, please let me know. I'll try to solve either in this session or in the next session. Even if you are unable to tell in this now, no worries. You can put forward your all anytime. You can put forward your queries through email or through these discussions during the all, because once in a week only we will try to interact. So you can directly talk to me, or you can put to your emails also. Please let me know. Until unless you don't speak, then it is very difficult for me also. Of course, I will be in a presumption that I can move forward like that. So you can stop me and you can interrupt me and you can discuss and try to clarify your doubts. Am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir.
So I could see around 42 of them are there, 43, 44. I think is a good comeback. Yes, I hope everybody is fine at their homes and their families are in a good condition. Hopefully, yes, things will be sorted out, I think. And we all wish and we all pray that the things will be normalized and we'll get back to our activities as to the normal state like 1.5 years back. Hopefully everybody is okay. If you had some hardships, yes, not worry. Please be strong and yes, you put your efforts and move forward. So please let me know if you have any queries, then just, if not, you can put it on the chat window. And as well, if you cannot speak, okay, regarding the evaluations, I will get back to you, those who are absent for the test, what are the other alternate solutions available with us. So I will get back to you on the coming Tuesday. So I will have a discussion with you and we will finalize those things. So do not worry about the assessments and evaluation. So please just be in regular touch with the course and do your activities. It need not be very fastly, but at least you need to be in touch. And you need to do it very regularly. Only thing is, I request you to do not go out of the focus, in the sense that don't think that only in the during the at the time of examination only you can open this, open the course materials and start reading. That will not help you in any way. I know that most of you might have studied these topics. Most of you, not all, if not all, most of you might have done this. Web technologies and internet technologies earlier in some other courses or in some other degree programs or some other platforms, you might have already gone through it. Please do remember, if you look on the Google, you'll see a lot of features, a lot of technologies, so much of stuff will be there. So don't confuse with all those things. And go, don't get even upset. It's not that everything you can learn at one go. So through practice only these things will be obtained. And we only make you to understand how the things can be solved with those technologies. So your smartness, your intelligence, and everything comes into picture. How best we can make use of those features in the various problems you'll try to solve them. I'm keep on talking myself only. Hopefully, you are able to understand my words. Am I clear to you, please? Hello.
Yes, sir.
I will just keep a pause for the advancements of the jQuery and AJAX. I will definitely cover these topics, but why I'm just keeping a pause on these topics at this moment is that a more important topic is there here, the Java programming and the JSP. Of course, so far we have looked upon the client-side technologies. Now we are to understand about the server-side technologies too. Since the second half of our semester now, since it has begun, and you will get a little bit less time, so I'll just take the more important time on these particular topics. Then once this is covered, and we can get back to the jQuery and AJAX. So of course, as far as the understanding point of view from the student, it will not create any problem. And I suppose you can get back to these topics at the end so that it will be also useful for you to do some other applications development easily in the later part of the other courses or other semesters for the project. So the most important part, that is what we are having to be completed. So as far as the syllabus is concerned, we need to understand before we go for the server-side scripting, the Java server pages, JSP, we call it as. Before you go to the JSP, you need to understand the object-oriented programming concepts and, of course, the features of Java as part of that understanding the object-oriented programming concepts. So those OOP, in short, we call it as object-oriented programming. Those concepts are those features of OOP and the characteristics of OOP can be easily understood by using this programming language Java. So once you understood about the objects and those characteristics and their features, how do you make use of those object orientations for various web applications? That is by using JSP that we need to understand. So as for the syllabus, we have to start to understand about the Java programming language. So I remember in the beginning of the semester, some of the students have expressed that they have not studied Java programming earlier. So, of course, if some of you have studied in your undergrads or maybe in another program of study, if you have studied elsewhere, need not worry. Of course, it will not be boring to you. So please follow the instructions, what I'm trying to you during this particular interactive sessions so that you can refresh your programming skills as well as you can recollect all those knowledge that you might have gained earlier in some other courses which are related to object-oriented programming. So those who are new, then definitely they have to put forward a little bit more efforts in doing more exercises. So anyway, for each class, as we practice, as we are doing from the beginning, you'll have your practice session for the topics which have been covered during that particular week's discussion. So once we complete the Java, maybe I will just take today and the coming Tuesday to complete the highlighted portions here. So the highlighted portions are the first three lines. So the first three lines are basically your introduction to Java, language features, language basics, packages and interfaces, exception handling, database management through JDBC, connecting to a database for creation or manipulation, and multi-threading. So these three lines, I'm trying to cover it in these 2 weeks, this today's session and coming next Tuesday sessions. Once we complete it, then we will move forward for the servlets for another 2 weeks. So this for another 2 to 3 sessions. So within 4 to 5 sessions, we'll complete this unit, and the last session, I will keep it for this particular sessions to be completed. One particular week, if it has been available for us, then we can have a discussions and of course revision kind of stuff for all the topics. So that's how my plan is, and that's the thing I just like to give the information to you. So let us move forward and understand the basics of Java, that is basics of object-oriented programming using Java language. So these are the topics that I'm trying to look into this aspect. Suppose, because see, remember, please let me just give you a caution. The same Java programming language, if you are going to, it can be continued for 10 weeks to 12 weeks up to multi-threaded programming. If you want to have the, all the features of Java programming language. So we will not have that much sufficient time to cover all the 12 weeks, please remember. I will try my best to cover all these important features very crisply and of course in a breadth wise. So as in the exercises, when you are solving it, you will go it in the depth wise. So we'll try our best to make sure that you not miss the most important points or the topics or the concepts related to Java programming language. So let me just come back to the slides. So this material is already available on the Moodle. You can download this for your reference in the later part for our preparation. Yes. So let me start with what is the Java programming language, or why this Java is required for us. You might have already observed, or you might have seen on the internet or through other medias. See, here you already studied C programming language most likely, and most probably you might have covered this C++, another object-oriented programming language. So if you see, we have different programming languages. You can have different technologies. Of course, these are C, Java, C++, Python, the JavaScripts and all. Of course, there are the most top programming languages as far as the market is concerned. Why Java? Why Java is almost a very important, very vital thing that is required as far as well, you are using the internet itself is. So when the internet era has begun, the Sun Microsystems, Josh Gosling is the person who invented. So the earlier form of Java is called Oak. Of course, I will not spend time on the history of this and all. You can go through any medium. So, what happened is the Sun Microsystems, when the internet era has started, when the internet working of computers is taking place, and the internet is coming. It is in the primary stage where people needs to have a programming language where the data can be easily exchanged. Across the internet, when the systems are interconnected, systems mean the computer systems, of course, not only computer systems, but the electronic systems do interconnect. Interconnect means they are interconnected and integrated to different platforms. So there was a requirement to have a programming language which can be easily accessible, designed for use in the distributed environment. So in the internet, you have a different types of computers, different types of electronic medias, different types of electronic systems. When I say different, even different computer systems, computer systems have different processors, CPU, different memories, different communication devices, so on and so forth. So when you write a program for a particular computer system to execute or run, it may be having a hard for that program to run on a different processor or on a different architecture. So you know what is a processor, you know what is a computer architecture means, and of course there are the different devices that are available on that computer system itself. So you run a program, and if that program, the one which you have developed the program on a particular computer system may not be able to run properly or even successfully on another computer system, because the their hardware, the hardware components, the architecture of the target system is different. So there was a need, there was a requirement has come when the internet era has begun, because on the internet, across this internet, there are so many different types of computer devices are getting connected with each other. And there is a requirement that the program, the software programs, they write it can easily run on all those different types of devices easily without any problems as such. Of course, when they say easily, to the maximum extent. So there was the thing that a requirement has come. This Java, it was designed to have the look and feel of the C++ language. So there's a C++ is another programming language, which is an object-oriented programming. So the object concepts, the object philosophy, is been taken into consideration, thinking that the object is nothing but any physical world or any real world object or any physical world thing. So looking into the physical world thing, how do we make this physical thing to be easily used, keeping all the philosophy of the real world objects, this is object-oriented programming software engineering concepts have been coming to picture. So similarly, along the C++, in the same line, Java has come to support the distributed environment, which is available on the internet, that needs to run different types of programs in a more easy manner. So Java can be used to create a complete set of applications that may run on a single computer or be distributed among servers and the clients in a network. So that is the main advantage that Java programs. It can run on a single computer or it can be running on a set of computers, a distributed set of devices which are internetworked with each other on the network. So of course, there are so many applications of Java. So if you start using the Java, you will come to know, of course, but to have a quick idea, Java can be used to develop graphical user interfaces. At the same time, Java, the same programming language, can be used to develop the complex enterprise operations and the scientific methodologies to be easily implemented and as well as to be executed. Not only that, it can be used for web-based and cloud-based, and of course for the gaming devices to easily function for different set of hardware devices. So this is just a quick view of this one. So to move forward, I will be just presenting the most important characteristics of the Java. So here, Java is to be, that's what I said, that the need for requirement of the Java is that the Java program should be able to run on different hardware devices when those hardware devices are interconnected over the network. So that is a need of that one. That's why the Java is basically a platform independent. So platform here means the platform is the hardware configuration, the hardware devices. So these platforms are of different configuration, sometimes at different CPUs, different operating systems, different, of course, memory devices, different communication units. So the program that you write in doesn't depend on that so-and-so source constraints. So it is a platform independent, so that the same program can run on any correctly implemented Java system. So if you look to the diagram, so usually whenever you write a software program, so that software program is going to be translated into an object code or into a machine code. So where the machine can be easily understand that code and the machine can perform according to that logic of the program. So in order to translate the source code into the machine understandable code, so there are certain translators. You might have already studied these. There are different types of translators. So those translators are basically translating from one form of source code to another form. So here, the translators such as compilers and interpreters, both are translators. Both are going to come into picture here while we are using a Java system. So here the Java system has basically, what happens is you write a code, you write it like a program. A program is a sequence of instructions. So those instructions are going to be given or are to be taken by a compiler. Compiler is another software, is basically a translator which converts your source code into another form, where that another form can be easily again converted or can be understood by another target system. So if you have written the C programming, you might have understood the C compiler. What does the C compiler do? So basically your C compiler translates your C programming into an object or a machine code, object code, we call it as a machine code, where that machine code will be helpful for you to run on that computer machine or the electronic device or an electronic machine. But here when you write a Java program, so that Java program, the source program, the source code, it takes into several stages, several phases, or several steps, in other words, before it tries to execute on the so-and-so machine. So here there are two parts. One part is basically a compilation part, and the second part on the right side, you can see it is an interpretation part. So the compilation parts, basically it compiles, it means the Java's program is compiled by a Java C compiler. Java C is the basically J-A-V-A-C, C implies the compiler, that translates the source code into a byte code. So the output of this compiler, that is the basically the Java compiler, what it gives you the output is the Java compiler gives you the output of byte code. So the byte coding instruction, we call it as a byte code. So this bytecode instruction is again taken by as an input to another software or another. Basically, it is a translator. It translates something. It is translating from your bytecode to a machine understandable code. So basically, that is being done by your Java interpreter. So this Java interpreter takes the input bytecode and converts into the corresponding machine code, so that that particular machine code it can be easily run on the target machine. So if you see the bottom diagram, you can understand, see on the right side, bottom diagram right side, you see there are different systems. So at the time when this Java programming is getting run, you have the Intel 486, 586, those were the devices. Nowadays you have the core i3, again i3, i5, i7, i9. We have much advanced to these things, but of course these are in the 95, 96, at the time when the Java is getting its initial phase of this implementation. So you can have Windows systems, you can have a Mac systems, you can have a Intel with different operating systems, or if you're Unix, or if you have any other operating system that may come in the future also, it can be easily adaptable. So what happens is you have different hardware devices, different operating systems, different configurations. So you write a program, if you see on the left side, the source code. So once the source code is compiled, in the compilation, usually it checks for the logical, your syntax errors, basically, and whether it is compatible to the language features or not. Those are been checked by this compiler. So once this is been compiled, the output of the compiler is a Java byte code. And that Java byte code is going to be taken by this JVM, Java Virtual Machine. And that JVM is going to translate into the machine code, which can run to the appropriate architecture of that machine or appropriate hardware resources of that machine. So appropriate CPU, the instructions, the CPUs of these different machines have different instruction set. So those instruction sets get the corresponding signals, in other terms, corresponding instructions that can be performed, that can be executed on that machines easily. So every target machine, the target machine on the right side machines that you see here, if you have the corresponding JVMs, if it is installed on that one, that JVM will take care of. If at all you compile the code on one machine, but still you will be able to run that compiled code, that prepared code can be also run on different machines which have been connected across the internet. So this is a basic understanding. That's what we need to understand here is you write code and you run anywhere. So write once, you are going to write only once, and you are going to run anytime, anywhere on the other machines on the internet. That's what the most advantages of having a Java programming language. So this is the basic feature of this Java. So some other characteristics of Java is, it basically it is a simple. When I say simple, it's basically a high level language. It's of course your means the user understandable set of instructions, English readable instructions. That's why like normal English language, the statement that you use like in your C programming, if statement or while statement, very simple statements like this, while or for statements or looping or control statements. So those programming language instructions are very simple. And of course it is portable. That is that portable comes here. You write somewhere on one machine, and the code that you have written on one machine can easily ported onto another machine, and it can still run on the target machine too. Then of course the robust programming, the memory concepts, the memory handling, how that based on the data driven. So the Java system will support to handle the memory operations very easily. That's why we have, this Java is said to be having a robust programming as compared to other procedural oriented, where you need to define the memory and you need to clean the memory. Whereas the Java, it has got a garbage collector. You can clean it and you can adjust to the memory based on the programming execution environment. And of course, Java do support the multi-threading. So what is a thread? If you want to understand multi-threading, let me just give you a little bit information here. So what is a thread? Can anybody tell me what is a thread means?
It is called
Hello,
light
am I audible to you? Oh, very good, very technical, very highly technical definition, lightweight process, very good, perfect. It's perfectly correct. But I am expecting an answer in such a way that even a person who doesn't know much programming will be able to understand.
Or smallest executable unit.
Smallest executable unit. As a teacher, I can understand it is acceptable. You are rightly said. There is no wrong in this answer. But still, you can further come down. We have to come down to a level where everybody should be able to understand and everybody should be able to get the point of what is called as a thread. Thread?
Execution.
Yes, please. Yes, Vinod?
Execution of one thread does not affect the method.
Execution of, can you please repeat? Execution of?
Execution of one thread does not affect the execution of another thread.
Okay, you are still in the technical. Execution of one thread will not affect the execution of another thread. Your answer is also right, technically acceptable, but still the people who are not very much into the programming. Yes, Pritham Rautray, he has given some answer on the chat. The answer what he has given is, let me just read out. Execution of sequence of instructions, very good. Yes, Tawab also has given. Threads are very useful in modern programming, where a process has multiple tasks to perform independently of the others. This is particularly true when one of the tasks may block and it is desired to allow the other task to proceed without blocking. Very good, Tawab. That is, your answer is well accepted. But I am just for a discussion and for the people to understand, I am just looking for a very low level meaning, not very technically looking into the aspect of threads. So Pritham Rautre has given a very good answer in just one line, execution of sequence of instructions. So please remember, yes, he has rightly mentioned, he's almost on the track, Pritham, very good. So what for the other students, please let me clarify you, a thread is nothing but sequence of instructions, that's all. One single thread is nothing but a sequence of instruction. Sequence of instruction. See, everybody might have written a main C program. Your main function, everybody might have written a main function. So what does a main function contains? Basically, a main function or basically your C program contains a set of instructions. Set of instructions is nothing but a sequence of instruction. So those sequence of instruction, instruction by instruction, it is basically a thread. A thread in computer terminology, in our IT terminology, a thread is nothing but a sequence of instructions. So when you run a C programming, you can go with only one main function or in one sequence, a set of instructions, one after the other only. Or in other terms, you go by instruction by instruction. But what happens is, in the Java, when you use Java programs or when you write Java program for different applications, when you write a program, so you can write a program where the sequence of instructions, that is nothing but a chain of instructions. In other terms, you can have multiple threads. Instead of having only one thread, having only a set of instructions, you can have multiple threads running in parallel, or it means you can execute the things in parallel. So executing the things also requires instructions. That's why the set of instructions for a particular task to be accomplished can be put in one thread. Like that, you can run multiple threads so that you can execute the things in parallel and you can achieve the performance, in the sense that you can complete your complete job task in a very less time if you are able to run multiple tasks or multiple execution of sequence of instructions in parallel. So something like when you're reading some data from the keyboard and your data has to be processed by your CPU. So of course, like this, and you're going to write some display onto another device, you are going to send some output to another display device. So all these things can be easily, if you can run in parallel, your entire task can be minimized in doing the things in parallel. And that parallelism can be achieved. And that parallelism is doing multiple tasks at the same time. Of course, when you do these things, then there are certain constraints too. There are certain points you need to consider. You need to provide resources to them, and resources means some CPU should be allocated to them. CPU, because nowadays computers have got core processors. You have a dual cores. It means two or three or four core processors are there. So you can use those core processors effectively and efficiently to run the things in parallel. So like this, we'll see how multithreading can be done. In the next week, we'll have one or two examples on the multithreading, and we can understand in Java how that multithreading is helping for us to solve the task in parallel so that we can minimize the time. So that is what Java is supporting. Java is object-oriented. That's what all your object concepts, the object itself, is going to be realized in the programming structure. In the program itself, you can put your object. So your object-oriented topics usually contain certain things, such as what are called classes, and what is a class, and what does they do, that we are trying to understand in the coming slides. I will get back to you more clarity on this. So these object-oriented things, object-oriented concepts do require the concepts of classes, their methods, and so on and so forth, and how those constructs or the programming constructs will help us to do better operations easily by extending some of those features, either in terms of inheritance or in terms of polymorphisms, some of the features of those object-oriented programming. So here, let me just, Java is designed as a core language. Of course, this Java programming language has a rich collection of commonly available packages that can be used for various applications, for internet, for distributed computing, for hardware packages, and also and so forth. So even your Java can be embedded in the web pages. That's what we are able to study. You can put your Java programming instructions on your web pages. That will make us to do your web activities more efficiently and more better way. So if you are looking for the how the Java programming execution does takes place, I have just provided one some small information to you. So begin with your Java source code. Usually all your Java source code files will have a .java extension for that particular program file. So the file which is having .java implies that basically you have written some Java programming instructions. So once this .java program is being prepared by you, it means you have written the source code. That is the source code, when it is given to your compiler, the compiler checks for any syntactical mistakes or something like the semantic to some extent, and it converts. Once everything is fine, then the compiler, Java compiler, converts that particular .java file into a particular byte code, So you can call it as that bytecode as a dot class extension 2. So this bytecode, Java bytecode, is basically a dot class file. Of course, you cannot understand as a programmer, as a user, we cannot understand. The bytecodes can be easily understood by the Java runtime interpreters. So these interpreters, basically, they take the input of the dot class file and generate the machine object code for the respective target machine to execute the set of instructions on that corresponding device, on that corresponding machine. So this is the basic idea behind how do you program, how do you just have an idea. Let us do the practice and you'll come to know. So before going to write the small programs, let me just give you some ideas about the classes and objects. So in Java programming, basically the class is the unit of programming. So the most important thing is in a Java program, definitely there is going to be something called as a class. So before we understand what a class is, let us understand what an object is. So tell me, what is an object? So let me just have some small discussion over here. In your own term, in your own words, can you please tell me what is meant by an object? An object contains, or what is to be termed as an object? An object is this. Yes, please.
It is called the instance of the class, sir. If the class is a logical view, and the object will create, will bring the physical thing, like it creates memory using, or we can like that, sir.
Right. Yes, technically acceptable, but still, if you want to narrow down to a general meaning so that everybody can easily appreciate and understand. So what an object is? Basically, an object is a real world entity, in the sense that you see, you are having a pen, a writing pen. So this is an object. You have a mobile phone. Mobile phone is an object. You have a book. Book is an object. So anything, any real world object that you take it into your consideration, that you see, which you can touch, which you can feel, which you can sense. So the table, chair, doors, lights, fans, everything. So whatever you see, whatever you can feel, whatever you can touch, whatever you can sense. So all those are basically your objects. So here, what happened is, now these real world entities or real world objects, these real world objects has to be represented in the computer. In other terms, how to present the real world objects information in the computer. So if you want to represent that real world objects information in the computer, obviously you require a program, so that the program will helpful for you to represent the real world object. So before, how do we represent that object into the computer in the using a program, let us understand what an object contains. So what is an object is? An object is any real world object which you can sense, which you can touch, which you can feel, which you can recognize. That is what we termed as a real world object. So please let me know what an object contain. Any real world entity you take it, what does it contain?
Attributes or features.
Yes, attributes and the features of that. So basically, attributes is the characteristics or properties, and some of those features, what that object is meant to do or what the object can do. So here, if you take a book, so a book is basically a book contains several pages and book. So what are the characteristics of the book, please? So consists of methods and properties to make certain. Yes, Tawab, you are right. So an object contains methods. But let me just tell to those who are very novice, it means who are just beginners, let them also can understand a little bit. I will not, of course, I will not bore you much with this, but let us go in this. So please understand, an object is what a book is, basically a book. Book contains pages. So this book has got certain dimensions. So the dimensions, you know, the length, the breadth, and of course, this book has got a title. Some information is there on the front page, front side. The book has published by the publisher, name is there, and the book has got number of pages. So like this, these are the characteristics. Characteristics, you can call it as attributes. You can call it as properties. Properties, characteristics, attributes all means the same with respect to the object place. So here object has got some information. So if you take a mobile phone has mobile phone has also got certain characteristics, certain properties. So it has got a color. Color is there. It has got size, the length, the width. So of course this mobile phone is of a particular brand. It has got a brand. It has got a model. It has got certain features, so on and so forth. Similarly, if you take some other objects, the objects like your any transport vehicles. So here, I just put forward some small examples for you to just get an understand. So if you look to a moving object, that is basically your car. So a car can be a Mercedes car, or it can be a BMW, or it can be an Audi car. So you can have all these cars, Mercedes, BMW, Audi. They're all basically your real world entities, your real world objects. So these real world objects, each object has got certain characteristics, certain properties. So basically, if you generalize these three cars, Mercedes, BMW, and Audi, basically they are three different brand cars, three different models, of course. But in general, there are certain common things are there. What is the common thing on these three objects here? Of these three different models, the common things is the number of tires. So there is a color is there for this car, and of course the car has got certain dimensions, that means that has got certain features. So these features of these cars and the properties of these cars, if you put them together, so the common properties of these objects, but there are three different objects, but no doubt those objects are having certain common things. So if you put those common things, if you put them as put into one unit, you can encapsulate those properties into a single structure. So if you see on the left side of this diagram, a car basic structure is there, the structure, the way the car is modeled, and it has got the number of tires. But that left hand side, it doesn't have the color, specific color is not there. That color of Mercedes, it is green on the right hand side. That is the basic object here. But on the left hand side, the same representation, the representation of the object, whatever the object you are seeing on the right hand side, this corresponding representation is given. That representation contains the common features. The features, those are the attributes, those are the characteristics, those are the basic common things. Those things are being encapsulated together in one particular unit. That particular unit is basically, we call it as nothing but a class. So that one unit which encapsulates, which something called, in software engineering terms, we call it as data abstraction. So the data has been abstracted. The abstraction is some generalized form of data is available and put together as one representation here. So that's what this particular class, it is meant to represent the common characteristics of those objects. So the name of the here, if you see the car, C-A-R, the name, this car name has got the common characteristics, but the car brand is different. Please don't confuse between these two things. So all the common things are put together under one name is basically called as a class, and that class has got a name. That name is basically, with respect to this example, this moving object example, this is your car. And the car's attributes are going to be there, the characteristics of the car, but the values of those characteristics are going to be different for different objects. That's why different objects, but the objects are the real world entities. Please remember, these are the actual things. Physically you see, physically you can touch, physically means you can really see, feel, touch, and sense. Those are the objects. The logical part of the object is nothing but your class. That class is only a logical part which helps you to represent the object in the computer, using a program. So it's the same meaning is there on the right side diagram also. You can see a car, the class car, that the properties, the members, or those the characteristics like the model, the color, and the brand. So each car has got really each physically you can see that each car has got a model number, a color of that car is going to be there, car belonging to a particular brand is there. So these are the different members, the data members, or you call it as a data miss, the data with respect to that car. So those attributes, those characteristics are put together in one unit called as a class. And of course, this object, what these cars are meant for you to do, or of course they are meant for you to transport, or transport means you get, they are meant for you to move forward from one place to another place, or they meant for you to carry some goods, or they are moving vehicles, of course. So the methods that for these objects will be with what speed that car is going. Speed is one of those methods. And what is the size of the car, whatever it may be, the weight. Of course, the weight comes again, the parameter is a data member, but of course, there are certain functions which you can make those data members to do some real actions. So those functions or those things are also called as methods. So basically, every Java program is all related about these classes and objects. So as a developer, as a programmer, you should also be having certain ideas about how to identify classes and how to go about with the how do you detect the objects in a particular problem definition given to you, and how do you abstract those information of those objects in a better way is all what you are going to study in your software engineering course. So that is very, very important for a software developer and for a programmer to understand how best you can represent or how best you can realize a problem statement into representation into a programming form. So this all comes through practice, of course, but to start with, you can start with very simple things. So a Java program is nothing but a collection of classes. So there will be several classes, several, it need not be just only one class. But for a beginner, you always start with one class, but later you are going to have in one program several classes. Each class is a representation of a particular object's information. Please remember that. So here, each class definition is going to be represented in a .java file. That is what your Java program is. And when you write in the program, because the classes do carry the data abstraction or the encapsulation of the actual representation of the objects. So basically, an objects are nothing but the instances of those blueprints of those representations. And those representations do carry basically the data fields. We call it as a data members. Data fields, members, the properties, all means the same here as far as the Java programming is concerned. And you also have certain methods, the operations which are carried upon on that particular data. So every class has got certain information. That information will be either in the form of data fields or in the form of methods. So every class will have this information which represents the particular objects, and those objects will help us to program it according to the our application viewpoints. So here, whenever you try to group the classes, so a class means contains a blueprint of an object. Basically, a class represents the logical form of an object. So this, when you put more classes together, grouping the classes together, you can make them as an application programming interface. Where you have your Java program, the core program, along with certain other collection of packages, where a package is nothing but a collection of classes. A package means is a collection of a class. It can be not one class, it can be multiple classes. So those packages are nothing but like, you can make them as libraries, like what you have seen in the C programming language, the hash include stdio.h. So like this, there's basically libraries, or in Java system, basically they are called as packages, where it contains collection of classes and their methods and their operations, how they can be used very much on their respective programming. So in Java, you have certain packages. Basically, one package is called as a swing. Of course, in the olden days, we used to have something called abstract windowing toolkit, or you can call it as application window toolkit. Of course, both Swing and AWT are meant for you to design your graphical user interfaces. Yes, so let us not spend time on these things, but also just to have an idea. So you have another package in Java called as util utility. So it can support various other data structures for you to use in your program. So all these packages can be included in your program with the help of a statement called import. And please remember, every program, Java program, will have a method called main where your execution starts. So like your C programming has got a main method, and that particular main method should also be there in your Java program, which will always be helpful for your hardware or the target system to start its execution from this particular main method. So here, a simple example, how do we write a small program? So here you see a statement import java x dot swing dot star. This is basically an importing the package swing along with other subclasses and the methods of this package called swing. Basically, a swing package is helpful for you to design and develop your graphical user interfaces. So here, this is just a package name. It is not compulsory. If you are using a GUI functionalities, if you need a GUI instructions for your program, then you need to include this package. So here, in this example, this is just an abstract example here. It's just a primary example for you to understand. So here, you have the main method. That is what most important thing. And this main method, here you can see there is certain signature for this main method. So what is that signature? This main method, it is like a function, basically. I can call it as a function, I can call it as a method. So what is that function signature of this main method is, you can see this is a public static void. So each one has got its own purpose. So here, you know, a function having a void return type, what does it mean, please? Can anybody tell me? If the return type of a function or a method is void, what does it mean? Hello, am I audible to you?
It returns nothing.
So function, if somebody is called this one, then usually methods and functions have been called by somebody. Somebody means it can be another program, or it can be another member in the program, or it can be some other program can call this particular function too. So usually functions and methods are called by some x. That x can be a function, or that x can be a variable, that x can be an object, that x can be some other function or some other program in some other package or some other place. So usually this function does not return anything to somebody. That's obviously a function does not return. You have to give the return type as void. And here there is a static a keyword which is been given to this main. Usually, if these functions are not being called by your objects, basically you mention that name static for that particular function, since it is not called by an object itself, it is directly being invoked by without having the object calling that particular method. So, and of course, there is something called access privilege. It has been given as public. So in Java, we have three different types of access privileges. One is private, the second one is public, and the third one is protected. So here we'll see the meaning of this public is it can be accessible to outside this particular class. See here, if you see this main method, which is from this open flower brace to the closing flower brace, this is the definition of this main method. This main method is defined in a particular class called hello. So this is the outer braces, indicate outer closing brace, and this is the class. So the class has got a name, and that is the unit. Basically, in this example, this is just a class without any object here. Please remember, at this stage, we have not created any object here. So just this class, because the main is just only one function which is getting executed, and this main method has to be in a particular class. And this public, obviously, it implies that it can be accessible, it can be seen, its scope is available to outside this particular class, and as well as to this package too, if you are going to put it in a particular package. So now coming to this class has got a name. This is the name of the class. Of course, you can, some of them will start with capital letters, some of them will start with small letters. So you need to look for this, how the a class name or how the class identifiers are going to be given to this. Usually the function names, if you see here, the smaller case, it's going to start. Of course, this class is also got an access privilege of public, which can be accessible outside this package. So if you noticed, this main function has got an argument here, args, that is arguments, or you can call it as a parameter, which are of string type. So main function of this type usually implies what? If you, those who have done the C programming, please tell me, you know, if your main function has got certain arguments or certain parameters, it means what does it imply? Yes, please. The main function having a set of arguments. Basically, those are called command line arguments, and those command line arguments are helpful for you to during the execution time, you can see what the command line values are, and those command line values have been taken by these arguments to be interacted with the functions or the logic that you give it in your program. So this is some of this basic information here, and if you see this, so once you prepare your hello.java, that is your program, it is to be compiled using Java C. And once you get the compilation successfully done, it means you are, your parsing is completed without any syntax errors. So you get a code that is basically called as a bytecode. Basically, the bytecode is of dot class file. So this dot class file is going to be given as an input to your Java interpreter, that is your Java JVM. So the Java Virtual Machine is the software, please remember. So then it starts running the program, start executing the program using your main method. So the same thing which is expressed in the diagrammatic way, please go through that. So similarly, for any programming languages, you have different types of data types. Usually the programming language supports, if you are going to store and if you are going to represent your data in the programs, you use different data types. So Java has got two different data types. One is basically your primitive data types, and the other is the object itself. So the object is nothing but basically user-defined data type. A user who is going to define his own data type, which is going to represent, basically is that representation of that data type is going to represent the real-world object itself. That object which contains your member variables and methods. So can you tell me what are the member variables and methods of the primitive data types that you have studied in your C programming language? Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir, audible.
Yeah, yeah. So are you able to follow what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
Yes, please. So please let me know here. So what does an object basically contains? Hello. What is an object? What is a real world object is? An object contains certain characteristics, certain attributes, certain features. Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
So an object, any real world object, you take it, it has got its own characteristics, that features of that, that is basically the properties. So that is basically, if you are going to represent that object in the computer by using a programming language such as Java, you will be using a class unit, a class structure. So that class structure contains the features of that object which you are going to represent in the program. So that class contains the data members and the, what does the class contain?
Data members and the methods.
Yes. So those characteristics, those informations. So each object here, it is written clearly, the data fields and the methods, data members and the methods. Every class contains the data members and the methods. Of course, these data members and methods, that they represent those physical world objects or physical objects or the real world objects. Now coming to this point, so if you look to the primitive types, what are the primitive data types that you have studied in your C programming language?
Int, float, character.
Yes. So your primitive data types, basically your primitive data types, what you have studied, your int, you might have studied floor, your character, all these are primitive. There's the basic data types. Integers are meant for representing. Int data type is meant for representing what?
Integer numbers.
You are positive and negative integer numbers. So you'll not be having decimal values numbers. Please remember integer. Similarly, float is meant for representing your decimal value numbers. Char is going to represent your set of characters that you use it in your programming for your identifiers, for your keywords, for whatever it may be, for your programming language, you create your user-defined variables and whatnot. So basically, these are your primitive data types. So here, now my question here is, if you understood the object concept properly, please let me know. These objects are nothing but user-defined data types. So there are only two different types of data types. One is primitive data types, another is user-defined data types, or a programmer-defined data types, or a programmer who is going to represent the real-world object in the program as a data type, he is going to represent it in the program. Now tell me, if you are going to represent or you are going to use the basic data types, the basic data types also have their own characteristics and their own methods. Hello, are you getting this point?
Yes, sir.
So what are those characteristics of those basic data types? What are the data fields and what are the methods of that basic data types, I'm asking? The answer is there on the slide.
Like we can apply addition, subtraction on integers.
Very good. So if integers have got, if you're using the int data type, the integer int data type have different methods. Methods like add, subtract, multiply, divide, or whatever it may be. You can you have concatenation? Can you have split on integers? You have only certain operations. Certain operations are not there. Certain operations are meant for certain things. So characters can have your split function. You can have concatenations. So those are for your the methods for the character. And similarly, you have for float also, you have different methods. Your add, subtract, multiply, divide. So your exponential, those are the different methods for your float. But what are the data members of integer? Yes, please. Member variables or the data members of the integer. These are the, you can see the numbers, what you are saying, -2, 147, 483, 648, to 2, 147, 483, 647. These are all the member variables. These are the actual values of that members, of that integer type. These are the permissible values. If you're looking for 32-bit integer, these are the acceptable values. If you're looking for 16-bit integers, these are the values, -32,768 to 32,767. If you're looking for 8-bit values, then these are the only permissible values, -128 to 127. So in Java, but this notation, we will not call these as integers. We have distinguished between this 8-bit, 16-bit, and 32-bit as byte, short, int. Similarly, if you're going for 64, they are called as long and float, double, and your character and your boolean. So these are the memory variables and the methods of this one. The Java programming language also supports what are the C programming languages that you have studied earlier. So it can support your index numbers, subscripts, function callings, member accesses, your pre and posting increments, the unary operator, plus the typecastings, type conversions. Suppose if you are going to create an object and you want to allocate certain memory for that particular object, you might have already seen in the C++ or your C programming in the earlier, when you studied the C programming data structures, have you used a new function or a new operator?
Yes, sir. In C, we used malloc and
malloc. So malloc, your memory allocation, when you're using malloc method, you might have used your new function to allocate the memory depending on the size of that particular structure. So the same way in Java also, we use this new operator to create some memory for the newly creating object or for the objects that are going to be used in the programming purpose. So you have the binaries, plus, minus, shift operators, equality, bitwise operators, bitwise, or, and same thing. The same operators are also going to be used here. So logical operators, whatever the operators are used in your C are all going to be acceptable in the Java too. So sometimes to have the compatibility and to have the conversions, you can convert from byte to short, short int, short into long, or from the vice versa. You can, of course, when you do the vice versa or something like that, you may lose some data, but you need to be careful when you do the operations, conversions in a better way. But this is also possible in the Java. So you can declare the variables, you can set some values to your variables using along with the data type declaration of that variable, you can perform certain operations too. And you can typecast those values using the corresponding target data types using within the braces. You can keep your double and you can convert that to a variable accordingly. If you initially it is int, then you can make it into double so that memory can be allocated and the data loss cannot be there. After when you multiply, the result will be very big. So when you cube it further, it will become big. So you can go for the doubles and other set of operations. You can do the typecastings that will be helpful for you to do. Similarly, when you are creating certain objects, we can use the variables referencings along with the names and that particular aspect. So you can, whenever you create a string or whenever you create a variable with certain names, that can be accessed through that particular value can be accessed to the variable. So you have the variable creating here, which is basically a string type. String is basically a set of characters. The values are going to be hold only for these particular characters. So here, here you are going to give the value to this particular string, and you can assign it, and this value is going to be accessible in the program for your reference purpose and for managing the things. So the same C programming languages, the control statements, like your if statement, if you your whatever the if, your for loops, and your all other looping statements, conditional statements that use it can also be used in your Java programming languages. So the same syntax, the same structure, do permit here, if else, switch, while, for, do while. So in Java, the most important distinguishing feature here is the methods, where you are using certain functionality for you to, those functionalities which are helpful for you, the object to be operated, the object, the real world object to be made use of. So the Java method defines a group of statements as a performing a particular operation. So those sequence of statements, those group of statements, you put it under one name, you can call it as a function, you can call it as also a method. So that method can indicate whether it is a static or a class method. So once it is made the method as a static, it means that static, that method is not called by an so-and-so object. But if it is a class method, it can, an instance of that class can call that method. So a method that is not static is an instance method that is called by, when the object calls that particular method, we use that as a class method. If that method is not being called by an object, is basically you have to declare that particular method as a static. That's why you have seen public static void main. Main has given as a static where an object is not calling that particular method main. All methods arguments are basically by call by value. So the arguments or the parameters that are inputted in the methods. So they, you know, the data transfer takes place by using the call by value method. So the primitive types is value is passed to that method. The actual value is going to be passed. A method may modify local copy, but will not affect the caller's value. Please remember it. That's why the call by value comes in the picture. So the object references, basically when you create an object, its address has been passed on to various other operations. So you can reference to that object by using its corresponding address. By address is basically by using that name of that particular object itself. So change to reference variable does not affect the caller. Please remember that object variable or the reference variable does not affect the caller. It means the person who is calling that object. But the operations do affect, please remember. So because the result value is going to change. So here in the class, there is a math. You can use for mathematics functions. So you can use the absolute value, the seal, the ceiling value, the top value. You can use the cos, exponential, floor. Floor is basically the truncated, the down values. You can find the max, min, power. Of course, all these math functions are available, square root, sine, 2 degrees, 2 degrees. You can refer to the textbook or to the materials whenever you're solving the problems. So you have to refer to what are the possible methods and classes available for you to quickly reuse them. So the advantage of the Java programming is the reusability. Please remember. So reusability means you, if you are using an existing class with the functionality, the same code can be used in another program too. So you need not write the programming logic again. So once you write, you can make use of the same program in other packages or in another programs just by invoking their reference and trying to use their methods. So that will be the reusability is one of the important features. That's why all these packages, they already been the methods have been defined. You can reuse them in your own programming applications. So let us now start write some small programs and examples, and we see how do you execute it. So there are various ways of executing your Java programs. So students who are having their own laptops and who are having their own systems, desktops and laptops with them, you can install Java Development Kit JDK from Sun Microsystems. You can download it and install the software, or you can use the other IDEs, Integrated Development Environments. So the Integrated Development Environments, something like you can use the Eclipse. Like here, if you see here, I can just show you this. I deleted the Eclipse. Right, you can use the Visual Studio or you can use the IntelliJ. So all those IDEs, of course, when you use those IDEs, you have to get the Java software also. The Java compiler, the JVM also should be installed on the respective machines. Those who are having the problems with the laptops and those who cannot install the Java, so I suggest you, you can go through the online versions. So the online, there are online Java compilers and online IDEs are there available for us. So you need not install it, you can directly start practicing by writing the programs. Yeah, CodeChef, you can go to the CodeChef, one of the most important. So I will be showing you this online CodeChef IDE. So you can write your code and you can compile it and you can run it and see the outputs, how your programming logic is functioning. So you need not install any software here. You can directly run it on this cloud CodeChef. The only thing is you please select the Java here in the menu. Are you able to see my screen, please? Please, yes, can you, anybody respond? Yeah. So I'm just taking this CodeChef IDE. People can start practicing this CodeChef from now onwards because software coding hackathons and practices can be easily done on this. Of course, this is not the only thing. You have several other resources on the internet. You can as well go for it. So you can use your own comfortable IDEs. So either you can install your Eclipse along with the Java on your system, or you can use your IntelliJ IDE or your Visual Studio, anything preferable for you, whatever comfortable. Those who cannot install the software on their own, you can as well use the your internet. If your internet connection is there, you can use the cloud platforms for you to practice online. So let me just write some small programs and let us see how this Java programming can be done. So once we complete Java programming, then we'll go to the GSP. So here, if you see, this is a program. So by default, when you select this Java option, the Java compiler in this integrated development environment, you come across to this importing the packages. So import java.util packages. .star, so all the classes and the methods that are available in this util package are also being taken into consideration if you are going to use some of those that are available here. java.language.star, java.language, the language features. Similarly, java.io, if you are going to read and write something to your outside world of this particular systems, then you can include these files so that your input stream readers, the buffer readers, or other programming when you are writing to files and all, you can use this particular package, IO package. Of course, this is by default, they are given. This is not compulsory package is required for us for all the programs. Depending on the programming requirement, you can make use. So along with this, I have just put some programming codes for you. You can sample programs are given to you. You can start practicing this. Just let me show you some of those programming. Here, also included here. Then, so can you please tell me what is exactly happened here? Yes, please.
Hello world will get printed.
Yes, the name of the class is Hello World, and the important function that you are going to see. One second, let me maximize this. Hope you are able to see the instruction now. Right. So you have a method called public static void main. So this is a public static void. All these are reserved words. These are your keywords. So once again, I repeat, every program should have a main method, and that main method should be present in a class. And usually when you're writing these programs in your desktop systems or in your laptops, you have to put this particular class name as your file name .java. Please remember, the class name and the file name should be same. Since you are running this program on this particular IDE, the code chef editor IDE, which is a cloud platform, here you need not worry about that. Basically, that class name will be usually main. So here I'm using, so please don't confuse between this capital M and the small m here, please. So the small main is the reserved and the keyword, please remember, and this is the main function where your execution starts from here. And since this is a method, this is not returning any value, you are putting the return type as a void. And this, since this is a method which is present inside the class and that is not invoked by an object is not calling this method. That's why it has been put as a static. And this method is to be accessible outside this class as well as outside this package. Of course, the package name itself is package CodeChef. This is an example. You can create your own packages with your own classes. Here, this class name is main. So just for your practice and example purpose, I have taken this one. So inside this main method, what happened is you have written two output statements. So here, if you see these output statements, like in your C program, you might have seen your in C, what statement, what are the formatted output statements? Your printf statements will be there. So instead of printf, you are using the same println. Of course, you are printing into the new line here. So this println is a method here, and that method is taking this argument. And that method is basically println method is invoked by an object here. So that object is basically an out object. So this object out is calling this method println. Please remember this basic thing. So, and that particular out object is again is member of that object of type class system. So the system class is trying to invoke this out objects to call this method println. Similarly, so in simple terms, you have to write your print statements like this to display something on your standard output device of your console device. So like what you do it in your printf statements in your C programming language. So similarly, system.out.println, some your format, some kind of literal string that you are going to put down here. So let us, once you write your class is defined and that class with having the main method is defined for you, let us now run the program. So you can see there's a bottom, there's a run button is there. And as well as if you are going to, of course, in this program, there is no input which is to be given in this program. But at all, if at all you have to give some inputs, then you can give the inputs from this custom input to this window. So that the corresponding, based on the input, the data get processed and the corresponding output you get received. So here I'm just showing you one output here. So once you submit your program and you're going to run this one. So successfully executed, so so and so time. Yes, this particular two statements. So since you use the println function, the next statement is put on the new line and the cursor is blinking to the next line, since that is also a println statement. If you don't want to put your output start in the next line, you can just as a go for the print method instead of println method. So this is one simple example. Are you able to get it, please?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes. Right. So now moving further. So let me just take to you another example here. Right. this program is basically to understand how do we use arrays. So in C programming, already you might have used this arrays. So what is an array?
Collection of elements of similar data type.
Very good. Collection of elements of similar data type. So here I am just preparing a program just to make you to understand a class, and the class contains the main method. Of course, so far in the last example, you have not created any objects. Please remember. So in this also, you are not going to create any objects. But let us understand just way to how do you write a programming class and a method, and how do you declare an array. So here, if you see here carefully, this is a class. The name of the class is a test array. So the definition of this class test array is nothing but it contains the main method. And the main method, what it contains is you are going to define an array. So what is the data type of that array? The data type of the array is int, and the name of the array is b. And of course, you have not defined the size of this array. If you might have remember your C programming clearly, you not define in your C programming. That's what you define your array before it gets compiled. Do you remember the size has to be defined? But here, as such, is not required, because in this example, the initialization depending on the number of values here, that much size is allocated for this B array. Fine. So now coming to this, once the array has been initialized, then you are going to. Can you anybody tell me what is exactly happening here in the next two lines?
We are traversing through the array and printing the each element by giving some space.
Yes. So what is exactly happening is we are traversing this array. Array contains some elements here, the five elements. So here the termination condition is you are going your index value up to b dot length. So you can easily get how many elements are there here. You can use the length. So this length it is predefined, and this is been defined into your language package. So here you are just traversing the array, and this is the length. It indicates the property of that array. And what is that you are doing? Yes, system router println, nothing. Then give you some space, and you are creating a variable called sum of type float, and is initialized to zero, and you have created another variable average avg. So once again, you are finding the sum of those elements, some of these elements of this array, traversing by one element at a time, and get the total sum here. And once you get the total sum, the loop is over, then you are trying to find the average, and you are displaying the average here, system route dot println. Is some kind of a literal string that we added. So here the concatenation operator plus is a concatenation operator between these two strings. So average within the quotes is one string, average variable is another string, so that you are using this operator plus basically as a concatenation operator to concatenate these two strings. So but basically this is a literal string. It has been already in quotes. It will be shown as it is, whereas this avg variable gives the corresponding value once it is computed here. So you can see here the same thing. Here there are two. One is your b of I array, and another is your the space the next. Then once you are getting the loop here, so you can use this concatenation operator plus here. So Java. So because if you start learning the Java, and if I start teaching it, the Java itself will take one semester, please. So I'm trying to put all the features in most of these examples, and I'm trying to make you to understand. So that you can quickly gear up for the practicing for the JSP. That's what the syllabus is meant for. So let us run this program. Then yes. So here you get see the elements are displayed one after the other with some spaces, and finally in the next line you are getting the average. Where basically avg is declared as a float. That's why you are getting the output with dot decimal values. So I just pause for 10-15 minutes here, and I'll get back to you. Then we'll continue our discussion. If at all in meantime, if you have any doubts, please let me know. Otherwise, just now it is 3:40, and I will be back at 3:45. Just 5 minutes break, please.
Okay, sir.
So let us continue our discussion. Am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So just moving to the another example. Of course, the three-dimensional array on my example I have given, so you can practice it. And so let me just go through another example where you can use a scanner class, which is basically a scanner class is available on your utility package. So this scanner class is basically will be helpful for you to scan your standard input device. So here I'm just trying to show you utility package scanner class. So here you have the first statement. Please try to understand, here we are creating an object of scanner type. So basically here what happened is in the main function contains an object. This is the object is SCNR. This object SCNR is of what type? It is of scanner type, a class here. Sorry, just one second. I am just opening the IDE again. So here, the program is basically in order to interact with your standard input device, that is your standard input, the system.in. The system class is calling is using a method called is using an object called in. So here, this system.in is basically helpful for you to make your program to interact with your input device, that is your keyboard. So to access that, what you do is we are going to use an object. So this object is created. This object SCNR is of type scanner. Like your int x is of integer type. Similarly, if you write some int a comma b comma c, where a, b, c are of integer types. Similarly, here you are using SCNR. SCNR is of scanner type. Simple, there's like a data type declaration. This object SCNR, this object is of this particular type scanner. So, but this is an object, a new object, so you need to use the new operator so that you can, an object instance is getting created, an object is getting created here, and that object of this type scanner, and that object, once it is created, it is been referred, it has been accessing through that memory, through a constructor of this particular class, scanner itself, getting the default parameter system.in. So this system.in will help you to access your standard input device. This object now is referring to access the input device which is connected to your system. So the object can interact with your input device, basically the system.in. In place the standard input device. So what is happening here is, sorry for the interruption, please. I was just started another meeting unknowingly. But anyway, I just close that meeting and I'm now continuing. I'm audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So here, we are trying to understand about the scanner class, scanner object which is created.
Sir,
Sir. Hello?
Presentation is off.
Oh, sorry. One second. Is my screen visible to you now?
Now it's coming, sir.
What about now? Is it visible, the program?
Yes, sir, visible.
Yeah. So here we are creating an object of type scanner, and this object, scanner object, is trying to interface with your standard input device, that is your system.in. The standard input device is your keyboard units here. So what we try to do here is, once we create an object, then the object can interact with your standard input device. So in this example, this object, scanner object, is trying to get an integer from the standard input device, that is your keyboard. So here we are using, to get an integer value, so we use a function called nextin. So it will just, this method nextin, you'll try to fetch a value from the standard input device, from the system in function. So that value is again given to the temporary variable A. Similarly, you are using the same scanner object, the scanner object. Now this time, again, it is calling one more time the next int method. So it is again trying to retrieve the, fetch the integer value, and again get a new integer value and store it in a temporary variable B. And of course, you can now, once the variables are fetched from your standard input device, so that a standard input device is your keyboard, once you fetch it and put it into your temporary variables in your program, now you can process them, you can manage them, you can play as you like. So here now the logic is, if A is greater than B, then of course the maximum value is this, otherwise the maximum value is the other number. So simple example. So this is because a Java program, because it is a platform independent and is going to run on the target input device, you cannot prescribe initially without the object referencing to the standard input device. That's why we give it in the program to interact with your standard keyboard. That is, your standard input device is your keyboard. So this program, let us run this program on the our CodeChef, then we'll see how it goes on. So your custom input, so here let me, because it is going to access that values, if you are running it, it will ask one by one because you are running on the cloud. So I am going to give the values here, something like 4, and now some random values you give it and you just run the program. So it will take the values from this and that is import your scanner, import error is there here. Oh, okay, sorry. Oops. Yes, so enter the two numbers. Once that statement is over, you have entered already given the input 4 and 9. The maximum number is 9. So that's how your logic is being performed, by collecting the inputs from the, of course, the standard input is here because you're running it on the cloud. That is, you're specifying those values as an input from this box. Otherwise, if you run the same program on your system, then it will ask from your keyboard only. So that is one thing. And coming to the next example. Yes, this is another example. Let us take another value from the standard input device with a real value. There's a floating value. All right. So this floating value here. This is an example to enter the radius. Yes, so the user is going to enter a value. That value is being taken by this object SC. The SC object is going to take the value whatever the user is going to end as a real value. Means, of course, this is a next double. This next double indicates that you are going to fetch a floating point number, or you can call it as a double number. Of course, the size of this variable means the memory size will be large, but it can withstand to this. So then that particular variable values radius is been given to the equation, and you are computing that to find the area of that particular circle. So here is something like that. Can you apply the mathematical formula? So let us run this program. So I'm giving something like 5.0 random value. Oops, sorry, the program is changed. Can you tell me what can be the problem that is estimated here? Can you predict any problem going to come here? Here I have not put the java.util.scanner, please remember, because already there is a statement util.star. This particular dot star will be taken, so all your scanner class is already included in this particular package. But if you don't want to put this statement, then you can put the previous example statement util dot, and you can specify the class, what classes you want to take it into your program. So here you get that area, you just computing this equation, whatever it may be, and the corresponding value, right? Yes, let us move forward to another example, class circle double. So this one example, you can see now we are creating a class, and the objects are going to invoke the methods of that particular class. So here, your main function is this. So please remember your main function, your public static void main. So inside the main, what we are doing is we are creating an object, that object name or the class variable. You can call it as a class variable, or you can call it as an object. This object is of what type? Is of circle type, circle user defined type, and this object is created with whatever the size of this particular circle class members do present for that particular class. So you are allocating a memory using the new operator with whatever the members of this particular circle class. There is a class, of course, this looks like a method name, circle followed by open brace and a closing brace. So for you, it looks like a method, but remember this method is basically nothing but this method name of this method is also referring to the class name here. So the class name here is circle. Please look onto this circle here. So this circle class, this is a class itself. This is a user defined. He is a programmer has defined. He has defined as a new data type. He has defined a new type for a certain variables to be created. So this variable is C here. C is a new variable which is created of type circle. So what are the members are there here? Please remember that members are double X comma Y, and there is another member double R. So basically there are three member variables. I call it as member variable. Members, they are members of this particular class. See, the class contains what? The data fields and the methods. So these are your data fields. Please remember the coordinates of the center point and the radius. These are your characteristics. These are your properties. These are your member variables. And this is the method. The method is circumference, and the method is another method is area. So there are two methods here, which the methods are going to be applicable to function or applicable to act on this particular circle entity object once the object is getting created. So these are your member variables, double X comma Y and your double R, and these are your methods. So whenever this statement gets executed, that memory is going to be allocated depending on the member variables, and that member variables are of what type. Based on that, the size is going to be calculated, and that much memory is going to be allocated here. So when that memory is going to be allocated, can anybody tell me? V during at the compilation time or at the interpretation time? See, always your Java program undergoes two stages or two parts. The Java program undergoes two different stages or two parts. The first part is the compilation part, and the second part is your interpretation part. So at what point somebody's Niklesh, okay, you have given the answer, interpretation, very good. So here compilation is only for checking your syntactical errors and your looking for the programming constructs so that they are written correctly or not. But your JVM, Java Virtual Machine, when it interprets your bytecode, that bytecode gets translated into your object code, and when it runs, then your memory is getting allocated on the target machine, on the target device. That's why the program, when it runs on the target device, that much memory is going to be allocated here. So that's the program that you're seeing here now. So here, once you this object gets the memory that has been allocated at the runtime, we can call it as, or at the interpretation time. So once the object is created with so and so variables, so what are the members of this class circle? The members of the class circle are your x, y, r. There are three members here. So you have to initialize the values to these members of this class. So the object c.x, this object is initializing the value 0. So your that object x, the object x, the object variable c has got a variable x that has been initialized to 0. Similarly, the object that is nothing but the class variable c, it has got a member variable y, and it has also been initialized to 0 here. And the next statement is the class variable c, that is your object, it has got a member variable r, basically your radius, and that is initialized to 5. With 5, 0. So here, these three members, once you allocate the memory, and once the object is created, then the object has got the values for these member variables by after executing these three statements here. Please remember that. So now, what this object is doing? This object is now, once those member variables are initialized to the respective object, the object here it is, here in this case, it is only one object. So that object, what it is trying to do here is, this object is now invoking, using the dot member operator, it is invoking one method. So what is the method which is invoked here? The method which is invoked here is c.circumference. So this is the c.circumference. C is an object, it is invoking or it is calling the method circumference. The definition of the circumference is given here. So what is the definition of the circumference? The circumference method, it has got a return type that is a double. So what it is returning here is, it is returning 2 times 3.14159 times the smaller. So the smaller, the value of that particular object C, the C object, the smaller are already given before to execution of the statement. This R value of that C is initialized to 5. So that particular 5 value is given to this particular R, that is what here. And that it is going to return the value. Where it is going to return? It is going to return to this particular statement, system.out.println, it is going to return here. So this is the point where you get the result here. So the circumference is going to be given the respective output. Similarly, this object C object is calling another method called area. So this area is another method that is already defined in the object definition. I mean, object definition is basically your class. That area function is this, and that area has got a different formula here. So this is going to return this particular value. Of course, it gets the value of R once you have completed this particular statement, which has been initialized to this R variable for this object C in the memory. So this is how a class and its corresponding member variables are going to be initialized, and they're going to be executed for the respective operations. So let us run this program and see how the output is going to look like. Since the values are already initialized, I need not give anything from the standard input or from this box here. So standard input, whenever you are giving the input values from the keyboard, please remember you need to use which class?
Scanner class.
Scanner class, yeah. So I'm just now executing this program. So the circumference is this and the area is this. So this is how you are going to initialize the members of this class by in the object or the class variable calling to the members, data members, and you are initializing them. And as well as that class variable or the object is calling to the methods of that particular class. So this is how you try to execute here. Then let us see, of course, now let us see what is something called as constructor. So here, constructor is nothing but a function which is having the same name as that of the class. So here, let us see what is the constructor is going to do here. In Java, something, a feature of the class and objects is something called constructor. So, yeah. Let me just put the code and explain you the what is the constructor is going to do for us. So here, if you see the program carefully, so there is your public static void main. So what is exactly happening here is this main method inside the main, always your execution starts from here, public static void main. So once you start your execution here, your the first statement of this main is nothing but circle C1 is equal to new circle 3.0, 4.0, 5.0. So you are creating an object that is your class variable C1. So this object class variable C1 is of what type, please?
Circle type.
Is of circle type. So where is the type definition of this circle? The circle type definition is here. See here carefully, this is the class circle. Class circle is here. So the definition of this class circle. So what the definition of the class circle will be there? Usually this circle class has got a definition that of the, it should have member variables. The member variables are your coordinate points and the radius. And it should have the methods, something like calc. Methods such as what can be the circumference of the circle and what can be the area of the circle. So this class from here to here, please remember this is what here. So here the closing brace and this is your corresponding closing brace here. So this basically, from here to here. So this class circle from here to here, you have the member variables x, comma y, comma r, and the member method circumference and the area, as you have seen in the previous example. But in addition to this, you also have another method here. Please remember this method name. This is a method which has got an open brace and it has got a corresponding closing brace, then followed by open flower brace and the corresponding closing flower brace, and it has got a function definition, the method definition, a sequence of instructions here. The sequence of instructions for this particular method. The name of the method is circle, which is also nothing but the class name. So the method name, which is same as that of the class name, basically is basically called as a constructor. Please remember this. So, and some definition is here. I'll get back to this. Coming to this, see here carefully. Now this object C1, once it is getting executed, the statement is getting executed, circle space C1, the object is instantiating to this particular class. The object instantiation is taking place. C1 is getting instantiated to. Instantiation or instance is both the same, please remember. So this object instantiation is taking place here, is equal to new. So the circle, by default, this is the name of this particular class. The name of the class is circle, and here also it is circle. So this is basically a method. But here in this example, what we have done is this this method, which is having same name as that of the class, is been defined, is been given some definition. It sometimes this function with the same name as that of the class may not be given in your class, but by default there will be the function which executes once this object is getting instantiated. Once the object is instantiated means the object is getting created, it will create the memory, it will be creating the memory based on the member variables and the corresponding properties which are existing in the definition of that particular class. So in this case here, when the object is getting instantiated, this C1 has got the parameters something like 3.0, 4.0, 5.0. What are these 3.0, 4.0, 5.0? They are the function arguments, they are the method arguments. That method arguments are mapping to this circle, the same circle method. So this circle method and this particular method circle, when this method is getting executed. So here, what are the parameters here? Double A, double B, double C. So A, B, C are three variables of double type. Those are the three arguments. So this call by value, this 3.0, 4.0, 5.0, 3, these three values are being passed or being mapped to this respective temporary arguments, you can call it as, or your functional parameters, you can call it as. So A, B, C gets the corresponding values. A gets 3.0, B gets 4.0, and C gets 5.0. And once you get these values, means you miss the program here, A value is being given to X variable, B value is given to Y variable, and C value is given to R variable. So what are these X, Y, R? Basically, these X, Y, R are your member variables of this particular class. So you are just passing on this object parameters or object parameter values into this particular once the object is getting created here. So your these parameter values are passed on to this memory member variables, the memory way, in the memory where the C1 carries this X, Y, Z with respect to A, B, C values. Similarly, the second statement, circle C2, this is another object. Please remember, this is object is different from C1. C1 is having a name C1. This is object is having another name C2. But this C2 is another object, but this is also of same type. Like car, Mercedes, car, BMW, and car, Audi. So Mercedes, BMW, Audi are of car type only. They have the common characteristics. Similarly, this circle is nothing but the same. Circle is having common characteristics for these different objects, C1 and C2. But the values are different here. So A, B, C values are double A, double B, double C. A, B, C, A value is minus 4, B value is 8, and C value is 10. So A, B, C values are being mapped to X, Y, R. So like this, there are two objects. So in the memory, one object C1 has got values 3, 4, 5 as X, Y, R values. And another object C2 in the memory has got minus 4, 8, and what is exactly happening with respect to these objects once they have been instantiated with the corresponding values? So these methods, these are nothing but called as a method, which method means a function which is having same name as that of the class is basically a constructor. So here system.out.println circumference circle, the output of this circle one, that is the circumference of the circle one, you are this method circumference is being called by the object C1. So once the circumference is being called by this object C1, C1 is calling the circumference based on the R value, what the R value this particular object C1 is having. So that R value is being taken into computation and that corresponding circumference output is being given. Similarly, the object C1 is calling a member method area, and that corresponding area function value is computed based on the R value. That is correspond the R value which is corresponding to C1's R value, which is nothing but here 5.0. So the next statement is nothing but your C2, this is another object. This object is now invoking the same method. That method, once it is executing here, please remember, it is going to execute this particular computational statement, taking the R value. The R value of this particular C2 is basically 10 here, please remember. So this time when this statement gets executed, the R value gets changed in the memory of that object, because the memory that is holding the C2 object has got that particular corresponding value. Similarly, C2.area. C2.area is this function which is R value, which is coming from the C2 object's R value. So that's why these are the different types. You need to understand how these objects are invoking those member values and the corresponding member methods here. Let us see this program execution. This is a public static void main in the class demonstration, and the particular objects are created of circle type with a constructor having the same name as that of this particular class. So that's what the constructor will helpful for you to create objects at the runtime. When they are getting created, they will have the default values. So they will have the corresponding values, whatever you set it when the object is getting created. That is the advantage of having the constructor. Yeah, already I put the program here. Just let me run. So that is what you can see. This R value is different for two different objects. So similarly, you get the corresponding circumference and the areas respectively. So, but the logic, the concept behind is the objects when they are created, their corresponding constructors will help to have the values of those members, the data member values when the object is getting created. That is the main point you need to understand from this example. Yes. So let us see. There is another point that needs to be understood by you at this point. At this juncture is constructor overloading. So what is called overloading? Overloading is a name, a functionality, in other terms, a feature. Basically, it comes from a term called polymorphism. Poly means many, morphism means forms, many forms. So here, if you see in this example, there is a class circle. So the basic circle definition in other terms that the data members are X, Y, and R. And it has got a constructor here, the circle constructor here, because the same name as that of the class. So this function, the circle, has got a function circle with three parameters here. Similarly, there is another function, there is another method with the same name as that of the class, but with one parameter of different type. If you see the type of this variable in this method circle. And there is another method, this circle, which is also a class type, that is, sorry, which is also having the same class name, but the argument type here is the argument, the C is the argument here. The type is circle, which is the class itself here, which is the class itself. Is here a complex type here. This class definition is going to be taken into another class definition to create another object C without the memory allocation here in this case. So like what you see here in this circle C1 only without the new circle like this. This is what the definition you can see here. So the instantiation without the object memory allocation for this. But what is exactly happening is, please see here carefully. This name of the class is circle, and the function name is also circle. So there is a function without a parameter. There are no parameters here, and there is a function, the same method with one parameter of type of parameter type is of circle, the class itself. There is another method circle with one parameter or one argument with a type of that argument to be double. And there is another method, another function with arguments three and of course the types you can see what are the double A, double B, double C. So there is a name of the method which is the same as that of the class, and the method name is same. The function signature is different here. The function signature means the parameters that you see here is three. The one parameter here of type double, another function with the same name. But one parameter with circle type and without parameters at all. So function signatures are different. So here we call it as these functions which are having the same name. Of course, the functions are nothing but overloading. And basically, these functions are basically the class name itself. So you can call it as constructor overloading. So functions are getting overloaded here. At one time with three parameters, at one time with only one parameter, and another time with only another one parameter, and another time with no parameters here. And of course, in addition to these function definitions or the methods, the constructors definitions, you also have additional other definition methods like circumference and area. They are also being existing here. So here, you let us see the examples here of what objects are getting created. So you have an object C1, as you've seen in the last example. The C1 object has got is getting created with three parameters or three values by calling this particular constructor circle itself. So once this statement gets executed, basically it gets executed here. This particular method gets executed, circle double A, double B, double C. Similarly, once the second statement, once the object C2 is getting created, once it is getting instantiated, and now it is going to invoke this particular method, new circle 5.0 with only one argument value. Of double type, of 5.0 is a double type. So obviously it is going to map and execute this particular statement. Now coming to a circle C3, the object of type C3. So here when this object is getting, but here this constructor circle C1 is of type class, basically circle class. So obviously you are going to get this particular value. So what are the C dot X, C dot Y, C dot R are there? They are going to be given to X, Y, R of this particular member variables. So here you are getting this corresponding the object C, X, Y, C dot X, C, D, C. C dot X corresponding the previous values are there. They're again given back to your X values. Then again, you have an object C4 is of type circle, but without any constructor arguments here. So obviously the method that is going to run here is this particular method. Once this method runs here, the data members X, Y, and R gets this corresponding values 0, 0, and 1.0. Instead of whatever it has been given, defined here, that when the object C4 is created, you will get this particular values. So in the memory, when C1, C2, C3, C4, all four objects have been created, in the memory, you will have the corresponding X, Y, and R values based on this constructors which are been helping for the objects to be created here. And the corresponding values of the circumferences and their areas are going to be created. So let me just give the demo of this one and you can see how this works. So this is basically a constructor overloading. So overloading is nothing but the function signatures are going to be different, but they're having the same name here. Function names are same, but the arguments are of different types and different numbers. Are you getting this point, please?
Yes, sir.
Let me run this program. So you can see the outputs of those programs, the respective values, and try to understand the basic concepts of constructor overloading here. So basically, function overloading is the same concept, but here with respect to this example, because it is having the same name of that of the class. So I just took this example for you to understand both constructor overloading and function overloading at the same time. Yeah. So just let us move to the next example. Basically, this yes, we have completed. Let us have understand the this operator. Yes. So let me explain to you, there is an operator called this, THIS. So what is this? The operator, this operator will always invoke the current object that is been invoked or that is been considered for your execution. Please remember that this is a keyword and that is basically an operator. So that operator is always, this operator will always invoke the current object or the latest object which is in programming execution. So let us see here. Can you please see this? There's another example here. What is this class name?
Student.
Yes. What is a student? Basically a student. Every student will have certain characteristics. So what are the common characteristics of a student? A student, when you come to the school, when you enroll in the college, or when you join, take a new admission, obviously every student will have a roll number. A student will have a name. A student is enrolled for a particular course, and the student is going to pay a certain fee. So these are the common characteristics. Please remember, these are the member variables of a student. So this, taking that common characteristics, of that particular student object or the student entity. The student here, we are considering the student as an entity here. We will not say simply object, but basically a student is an entity. That entity has got, these are your member variables. So of course, here you have a method here. The name of the method is student, which is same name as that of the class. So this method or this function also has got certain arguments. The arguments are your roll number, your name, and your course as an arguments here. So here, this is the, basically it is a constructor. Please remember, it is a constructor. So because there is the same name as that of the class, this constructor, it has got certain parameters here, fine. So it also has got an another method here. So student, please remember here, the student is also there here. But this constructor has got different parameters. So roll number, name, course, as well as fee. There is one more argument here as compared to the previous method. So this is also having the same name as that of the class. So what is this basically? Constructor overloading. Constructor, the constructor is the one that is getting constructed. When the object is getting constructed, that is the object is getting instantiated, the object is getting created on the target machine at the runtime. So here S1 is of what type? Student type. And the student type is now getting a values here, 111 Ankit and Java, something like this. So here you are creating an object, that object name is S1. So when the object is getting created, it obviously is going to invoke a method with these three parameters. The object with the three parameters is roll number, name, and course. So here what is exactly happening here is this roll number. So what are the values you specify during the object creation? That values are going to be passed on to this respective temporary variables. So roll number, name, and your course. So this, please remember here, roll number, name, and course, which are on the right-hand side. Please remember, this right-hand side of this assignment operator, you can see here, roll number and this assignment operator followed by name, assignment operator followed by your course. This right-hand side, whatever you three are referring, these three are referring to these arguments, please remember this. And now, since they're having the variables which are of the same name as your data members of this particular class, so please, you have to create, because this is going to refer to this object now. This object is S1 object, please remember it. So that S1 contains, the S1's roll number is going to have a certain value. What are the values that is coming from this particular argument? Similarly, S1.name, similarly S1.course. So this is going to refer to the object which has been now called. This object is now is been called. When this object is getting created, these values are going to be assigned to this object, and that is been made possible for using this particular roll number. If you don't write this for this roll number, see here carefully. This, if I remove here, this, then there is a problem called as namespace collision. So namespace collision for the JVM, the JVM Java virtual machine will not understand which roll number are you referring. This roll number is referring to this as a data member, or you are referring this roll number, are you referring to this variable roll number. So that is the problem here. So that's why you are using to differentiate between, to have the clarity on the namespace collisions when the variables are having the same names here. You can use this operator. That's why you can say this operator, or this is a keyword to refer to avoid your namespace collisions in the programs. And during the memory allocations and memory processing, they will refer to the exact variable names. So that's what this keyword is meant for. So let me just run this program. So you can see here. Now in the second object, S2 is being created with another fees also. So the floating point value here, 6000 F, that's what your floating point values have been here, because you always in Java, please remember, a value followed by F, small f, indicates it is a floating point value that you might have given. So far you have not seen a floating point number. I have just shown you a double number. Now you can see the floating point number value over here that has been considered here, and you are invoking. So once you create the objects, and now that objects S1 is invoking a method called display. So what has been the display? The functionality of the display is just to display that corresponding object's roll number, name, course, and fees. So that values for S1 and for that values for S2 will be displayed here. Let us see when it runs how the output is going to look like. So here, because the fees value for that first member operator is not given, so it has taken zero value. Otherwise, here we are not specified anything. So here, zero value has been taken for this S1 object. The other fee value has been displayed here. There's a floating point value, right? So let me go through. Yes, please. Yes, please.
What is that reusing constructor, sir?
What is that?
In the second student class, like this reusing constructor is written, sir. like that statement that this in brackets rule number.
Okay. You are referring to this objects. What we have done here is this is another method. This is a constructor method which already we defined here, right? So we are referring to the superclass here. The superclass is basically is your this particular class itself. You have a super method here. This is a method student, which is again you are referring to this only. Basically, you are referring to this. The previous method of student definition. So when you are referring to this, in addition to this, you are referring to another variable called fee here. Okay, sorry, I forgot to tell you about this. Yes. So basically, you are just this is one way, or you can do like you can write this dot roll number is equal to roll number, this dot name is equal to name, this dot course is equal to course, then followed by this dot fee is equal to fees. So instead of not repeating this three statements again, you can refer to this particular. So you are using this constructor again. This is the constructor here. You are using this constructor here instead of writing it again. That's why this is called reusing constructor here. The definition of this constructor is used again here. That is the meaning here.
Okay, sir. Got it, sir.
So let us move to a special use of this keyword, no object relation to invoke a method. So anyway, I will just stop this one. I will just keep pending for the next weeks to continue. So one example is there. And of course, the slides, whatever the slides I have given to you now. So please go through this. So I have covered up to already these things are done. And So right, this is the string class. Let me just go through this, some of the slides with the string buffer and the string tokenizer that will help you for you to do the exercises. So here, as you have seen in this some of these examples, we are using the string type. So you might have seen here while the names, name character, set of characters which you are going to refer to a data type called string. So the string class defines a data type that is used to store a sequence of characters. So you cannot modify a string object because that is the value which is going to be stored in the memory. You have to create an object and you can modify it using the new objects like this. So, but when you are comparing it, you need to look for the corresponding operators. So you can't use the relational or equal to operators to compare the two strings like equal to equal to. So here, when you are using the strings, you have to use is equals to. A method is already been specified for you to compare the strings. So please remember that is important because these are two different memory locations, two different pointers, and they are referring to, and they are not going to be on the object's values itself. A string buffer. This is another type which is almost similar to string, but not exactly the string. So here, when you define certain string variables as string buffer type, I'm referring it. Reiterating it again. Then you are going to create or declare variables of string buffer class or of string buffer type. You can modify the contents. Whereas when you are declaring variables of string type, you cannot modify it. So that's what you say. You cannot modify a string object. Whereas if you are creating a variable of string buffer type, then you can modify that particular thing. So buffer will be helpful for you to manage the things and you can change the contents here. So the string buffer itself is that's what it is present in your java.language .language package as a string buffer class. And the string buffer class do support certain methods. So those methods are your delete, insert, your replace, your substring. All these are two string, even if you want to convert from the buffer string to your two string directly, you can convert this. And you can also have another class called as a string tokenizer class, which you can directly play with the strings. So because string tokens, if you want to make it into small tokens, so if you want to break the string into small characters like this, and you want to check whether there is some, if you are going to have some logic like what is the character present in the first character of the string, or what are the three characters in the middle of the string, or what is the end character of the string like this, you can make, depending on your application, sometimes you may require to token, means you make it into small parts either into two characters or three characters, or basically your substrings, those are. So, or you can make it as a tokens of that particular string. And you can use these methods, tokenizer as more tokens and next token methods, for you to play with the strings very effectively here. So here, wrapper classes for already I mentioned for you for the primitive data types. So you already your primitive data types are there. You sometimes you require these wrapper classes that will be helpful for you to play with numbers very easily here. So the wrapper means something wrapping the basic data types, integer, float, and your character. Those data types you can use it. So we already have just given you something like, I have not discussed about the final keyword. So once the final keyword is mentioned for a particular variable value, means you cannot change the value, please remember it. So here, this variable, the word age, this is the variable name, which is of integer type, and that particular variable value has been defined with 18. And you have been given that value as final, means you cannot change. In the program, the logic execution cannot change the variable's value. It's something like constant, giving a value to this. And of course, these values are these variables are not getting a value from your object invocations. You can make it as static. And if you are putting the access privilege for this statement as private, then this is going to be belonging to this particular class only. The class name here is person. So this person class only, for them, that particular person class only, these variables are going to be accessible, and their scope is meant for to use in that particular class only. That is the meaning of this particular private access privilege, and as well as this keyword called final. Constructors, that's what just we have seen. Some of those constructors, when they created those corresponding member variables, gets the values which are defined based on the values which are passed from the class instantiation. So this is one example, and of course, mostly, please remember, every class will have, most likely you'll have a modifier and as well as an accessor. So these are the two generic names. Modifier is nothing but trying to modify something, a data member variable in your class. Accessor is nothing but trying to get some value from that particular member variable from that class. So usually this modifier is basically called set, and accessor is basically getting. So this set, setting the values to member variables is one method, and getting the values from the member variables of the class is another method. So most likely these two methods will be there for almost all the classes, and most of the applications do have this. So you can put some values, you can set some values, you can get some values. So these two methods are basically called as modifiers and accessors that will help for you to prepare your classes. And you have certain other member methods which always going to be useful for you. You can invoke the member methods by calling the methods itself, and you can have those operations in the method either by getting the outputs as a boolean values, or just returning the values and so on and so forth. All returning values, you have seen it, just I've given an example like a boolean. It can be a true or a false value here. So you can use this concatenation operator, plus operator, for you to prepare a formatting statement, or which you can concatenate given two or more strings to give the proper output in a meaningful form. So here, the same person class, of course, here you are using the equals. That's what you cannot use the, please don't use those equal to. You can use the equals methods using your string buffers and others. So these arrays, already you have created an array, and those index values are going to be stored in the memory, in a contiguous memory locations for an array value. Similarly, that students' grades and all, how to access this, you can use the length method, and you can format. You can use the printer function to, if you want to put in a output in a formatted way. So the same, some examples, you can use it, which you can run it clearly. Sometimes this is another important method here. We call it as a parse int and a parse double. Basically, you are converting the string to numbers, either to integer number or to a floating point number. So you can sometimes you can take the input from the user in terms of strings, and in the program you can convert that string value to corresponding either to the integer or to the floating point number. So here already I have told you the input and output using streams, the system.in, the system.out. System.in is basically pointing to the standard input device, the keyboard. From the keyboard you will get the data to be read onto your class variable which you created. Similarly, you are going to system.out, that's why you use system.out.println. You are going to display something onto your standard output device. So you can use the system.out to the console window or to the console device. So suppose you are reading some data from your files itself. So you can use your classes like a buffer reader class, and you can use the buffer reader along with the file reader to read data from your files. Like what you do in your C programming when you read the data from the files. So from the command line arguments, you specify the file names and you can start reading the files and you can start playing the data that is coming from the files. So you can use the, as I mentioned to you, string tokenizer. You can use the string tokenizer to play with the strings and to understand how you can manipulate the strings. Either you can split it with respect to a delimiter, you can split it, you can get the corresponding pattern. So you can use the regular expression in the utility package. So you can play with the strings and try to understand them. These are the some statements which are going to write it onto your print stream. And yes, these are the points that we discussed for today's session. So what is Java program, what is JVM, and what are the primitive data types, and what are the different control structures, and on the string and the string buffer classes, along with the examples on equals, compares, and arrays, and a little bit idea on the stream classes of input stream and the print stream for the standard input and the standard output respectively. How do you print data into this? So of course, you can go through this. You will get an elaborate notes, and most of the points are taken from this. And so what I am trying to make you to do for an exercise is just prepare some of these exercises. So please try to answer it. Of course, you need not write. You can exclude this particular seventh, or you can try it. Just try method overloading, and you can just try method overloading, overriding, and abstract classes. I will go through in the next class. So, but at least overloading, you can try to do this example problem seven number. So up to seven, you please do it. Of course, there is no evaluation, there is no assessment, but I do expect you to submit the assignments either by next week or to the next week. It is not like an assignment, but you need to show me the at least submit the outputs. Even if you don't show, I'm not going to consider it as an assessment, but it will help me for you to prepare some practice, and it will gain some skills for you to. You can give some work to your brain and try to do it. So don't skip those problems to be executed. So please remember, one, definitely there will be one test. So one test, I will tell the test date before. So we are here now, Java language basics, and so packages and interfaces, exception handling and database management, that you will see it in the next class. And if time permits, the multi-threading, I will go through it. Once we complete the Java programming in another one or two classes, then we'll start the JSP. This is a very vast subject, very vast features are required. But as for the syllabus is concerned, just the very primary basic things are needed for you to understand to go with the JSP. That's why the syllabus is, I'm just a little bit fast in making you to understand the Java programming. Because if you start explaining each and every line and each and every feature, it will take definitely a semester. I hope you are able to understand it, what I am trying to say here. Very important things only I am trying to convey to you. Yes. Once we complete it, we will get back to the JSP very quickly, and we can complete the JSP very easily. After that, we will come back to this in the last one or two weeks about the Ajax. Yes. Any doubts here, please let me know. Hello, am I audible to you?
Audible, sir.
Please let me know any doubts if you have. Are you able to understand? No?
Yes, sir, able to understand.
Able to understand. Only Raghavendra is responding. Already some of the students have left now by the time end of the session. So 3 hours attending the class is very boring, right? Yeah, Niklesh, you are very good, very active, very good. Good. So no worries. If you have any doubts, you can put forward. No problem. It's almost now 10-15 minutes is remaining for today's session. So yeah, please let me know if you have any doubts. I can try to clarify you. You not with this, you can talk in academics or any other course. Course in a sense which is related to our course only, of course. Let me know if you have any doubts.